Welcome to the video. We are going to tackle something quite amazing in this video. And we don't need to be in too much of a hurry to do so. Relax into it. Very advanced looking inquiry, actually. Precipitated by a dream I had last night. It was quite an extraordinary dream. I found myself being led by someone saying, come here, come this way, come this way. Like a trail guide. We went up along this trail, seemingly along a sort of a mountainous area. And I found myself on this very narrow trail. And it got narrow and narrow. And there was this huge gorge, chasm, you know. And I sort of got a little nervous. And then my guide said, look out here. And we looked out. We were on like the precipice, like the edge of a precipice almost. And it was, couldn't see any of the landscape near us at all. It dropped off into a total chasm. But in the distance was the landscape of this planet. But like the surface of this planet in a flat panoramic form. And what was shown, it was all of the construction on the super-sized skyscrapers and buildings throughout the world. From left to right, I looked, and here was this country and this project, this country and this country. It was all like laid out, the earth laid out in a flat way as a landscape, like looking out over the Arizona desert or something, you know, or just huge total panorama. At a distance, quite a distance. And I was watching and seeing all the different monuments and skyscrapers and how high they were and in the world and how they were building bigger ones and everything. And then I looked down and I realized I was right on the edge of this precipice and it was, the path was kind of tilted. And I just saying, my gosh, I'm, you know, if I might slide right off the edge of this cliff. It was a precipice, terrible precipice there. And this is quite common dream of being on the edge of a precipice and feeling like I'm going to slide off the precipice. But the vista was the earth in a flattened way like that. Instead of a globe, it was a flat panorama. All of the continents and all of the great buildings. So I said, wow, but scary. You know, what do I do about this? And so I kind of woke up and started thinking about it. In a flash, I realized, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I'm dreaming this. Maybe it's just a dream. Who is this person up on the ledge there? And somehow, it was an intuitive leap. I somehow remembered that someone was talking to me down on a road, and I may have fallen asleep on that road and be dreaming that I was up on this precipice. I wasn't really there. In other words, a dream within a dream. And suddenly that clicked. And then that led to today's breakthrough. Today's breakthrough, which is a very significant breakthrough. I have said that where I am, there is no no down. There is no down. There's no down. There's no precipice. There's no down. It's impossible to fall down anywhere. It's impossible. Where I am, there is no down. And here, but here I was, on the edge of this, just total precipice in all directions. You couldn't even see where you'd fall to. You just like a void, almost virtually a void. Looking out, and maybe the distance might have been like looking out like about 60 miles, 100 miles, or the landscape of the world was quite a distance, and the huge buildings seemed very kind of small. Overlooking the world like this. So I said, I can't be there, because where I am, there is no down. No height, no depth, no way to fall down at all. And so that's when I said, oh, wait a minute. Maybe this is a dream. But then who's dreaming the dream? And then I remembered that I may have just fallen asleep within a dream and be dreaming within a dream a dream. Okay, got it? And this seemed to then trigger something absolutely amazing. And what it was is that there was this realization that there's only one dreamer and there's only one dream. One dreamer and one dream, but, and I'm, get this, but the dream, the one dream that this dreamer is dreaming is a dream of many dreamers. There's one dreamer and one dream only. Yet it's a dream of many dreamers. Not only that, it's a dream of many dreamers dreaming of many dreamers who are also 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 dreaming of many dreamers, and on and on and on and on and on and on. Yet all of it is actually only one dreamer and one dream. And yet it seems like many. And yet it seems like many. Full disclosure here, I was so exhausted today, I had to drive, I was driving, and I found myself like kind of drifting in the lane, and it's just, wow, I was just, you know, kind of zoning out a little bit, not good. So I had to drink like half a bottle of Diet Coke just to try to keep myself awake, but I'm very tired. But that was after I'd realized all this. It was after I realized all this. I guess I'm under, you know, tremendous strain, so I'm very tired underneath the surface. And you might expect that. This is an astonishing consideration from the mind. It just boggles the mind, really. But phase four is when you're able to handle this sort of stuff, because of the discipline you developed in phase one, two, and three. Keep in mind the discipline you're developing in phase one, two, and three yields fruit down the road, because with this discipline you're able to entertain this idea that I have been entertaining today. It seems like every day is another idea that I'm entertaining. It's just really quite expanding the boundaries of consideration here. One dream, one dreamer, and one dream only. Just one dreamer and one dream only, but it's a dream of dreamers, dreaming dreamers who are 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 dreaming dreamers, on and on and on and on and on. But it's all just one dreamer and one dream. It seems as though there are all these separate dreams, right? Because a dream of dreamers, dreaming dreamers, dreaming dreamers, dreaming dreamers, dreaming dreamers. If we don't realize that what's going on is a dream of dreamers, dreaming dreamers, dreaming dreamers, we think that there's all these separate dreams going on. You see? But there isn't. There's only one dream and one dreamer. We think there's all separate dreamers, separate dreams. There's only one dreamer and one dream. So this is what's called a heavy insight, because the ramifications of it just boggle the mind. But this is where the discipline comes in. Full stop in the now. He says, full stop. Don't make anything of it. Keep the discipline going that has been developed throughout the years. with an understanding, of course, I understand the magnitude of this to some extent. It's kind of obvious. But then again, don't make anything of it. Just keep going. The one that appears to be many. You've heard that before, maybe. The one that appears to be many, but it's only one. And now I can see, I've seen this, you know, why? A dream of dreamers. Dreaming dreamers, on and on and on and on and on. Yet the whole thing, all of this dream of dreamers, dreaming dreamers, dreaming dreamers, is actually just one dreamer dreaming all of it. Right now, one dreamer dreaming all of this. And that dreamer is the self, spirit, the self. There aren't any separate dreamers at all. And yet, because this dreamer is dreaming as if it were, it seems as though there are all these separate beings living their lives, doing this and that, living this dream. This is very similar to what Ramana Maharshi pointed out in the Sargadatta Maharaja inquire, I am, who is the I? Find the I, find the first thought, meaning find the dreamer. And what is the dream? What is the first thought? It's the dream thought of a dream of dreamers, dreaming, having a dream of dreamers who are dreaming dreamers, who are also dreaming dreamers, who are also dreaming dreamers. And so go back to the root, you see, the root of it, and see, this is what Ramana Maharshi, I believe, is talking about. And that there's some sort of spontaneous resolution to it when you're able to get back that far. Same with Nisargadatta Maharaj saying, this is the same thing. I am. Where I am is no downness. Where I am, there's no down. There's no precipice at all. No heights, no precipice. It takes heights to have a precipice, doesn't it? You can't have a precipice without any heights. No downness. You can't have heights with no downness. Same way as of saying the same thing, right? You cannot have heights with no downness. You can't have and so there's no heights, there's no precipice, there's no downness. So again, the dreamer, one dreamer, one dream, the dream of dreamers, the dream of dreamers. Now how many dreamers can there be dreamed about? Endless, right? There's no limit. How many of those dreamers are actually real dreamers? The answer is zero. Only the original dreamer is the one who's actually dreaming. All of the dream of dreamers, all those dreamed of dreamers who are also being dreamed of as dreaming dreamers, and on and on and on. All of that is all being done, dreamed by just one dreamer. Always. So, again, to just remain calm with this and don't make anything of it. Just stay full stop in the now of the wow. This is the discipline, and so it pays dividends. It's like an investment. It's like you're investing in some blue chip stock, a spiritual path, and you know it's a long-term investment, but a lot of people have done that with certain stocks, and eventually when they get to be older, retirement age, they have a tremendous amount of wealth. Well, we're investing on the spiritual path with our practices, our disciplines. How are we paid off? Where's the wealth? By insights like this. And see, this is different than just reading something in a book. This is, I actually experienced it. I saw it. I realized it. I intuited it. It's something that came out of organically out of my being. Of, hey, I can entertain this consideration. Totally different than reading something out of a book. It's beyond words. I'm just citing some words to point to it, but it's a feeling like, wow, this could very well be true. And feeling like the ramifications of this are just, I don't even know what to make of it at all. So this is where one has to remain, being able to be poised, full stop in the now of this wow. Because who can calculate the ramifications of this? Don't even try, you see. So by not even trying, I stay calm with this. That's what it takes to entertain something like this. The ramifications are if you try to chase them down, you're going to be so fragmented the mind's overstimulated and you can't sleep, you can't freak out, you'll be obsessed, all this stuff. But with this practice we've been doing here, the thought of calculating, chasing it down, doesn't hardly even arises at all. That's not even an issue. So those are the dividends. Again, look at your spiritual path as if you're planning for your retirement. And you need to make, really wise investments in some real blue chip stocks. Now, where do you go for stock advice? Stockbroker? Someone who'll give you great advice? A lot of those people who are good investors have very good stockbrokers, very good advisors, financial advisors that, pick the stocks for them. On the spiritual path, where do you go? Well, you go to top-tier teachers, I would say. Top-tier teachers. Well, those are like the blue-chip stocks, actually, right? Invest in the top-tier teachers. Who are the top-tier teachers? Top-tier would be like a long jumper, for example, a Ramana Maharshi, a Sri Sri Anandamayi, and last but not least at all, Jesus Christ, absolutely. See, those are some top-tier teachers. And look at it like blue chippers, top tier. Don't get into the trap of comparing these top tier teachers. What a waste of time. Top tier is top tier. They're going to pay dividends, okay? That's all that counts. So I've put my attention in this lifetime on these top tier teachers. And planning for my retirement. But what kind of retirement is it? I don't have any money at all. I don't have hardly a penny for my own retirement in this world. But I'm planning for my retirement in some way. Maybe a retirement from what delusion? So putting one's attention on these top-tier teachers pays dividends. And the dividend is to... All of this is one dreamer, one dream, but it's a dream of dreamers, of many dreamers. And these many dreamers is a dream of many dreamers, dreaming of many dreamers, dreaming of many dreamers, dreaming of many dreamers, dreaming of many dreamers, on and on and on and on and on and on and on. Now, it's helpful that you know these top-tier teachers that saying such a thing, nothing overwhelms them or surprises or shocks, or they say, wow, that's really heavy or something. No, whatever the truth is, they know it perfectly well. So there's nothing that phases them, nothing that is a continuity problem for them. So it helps you stay very even-keeled. Whatever you've done, they've already been there and done that. So, a dream of many, many dreamers, dreaming of many, many, many dreamers, dreaming of many, 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 many dreamers. But how lost are we really? Do we need to follow the chain back, really? Just see the dream at its root. What kind of dream is it? A dream of many dreamers. Well, don't struggle with that. What we want to do is get used to this insight, discussing it, talking about it, just sharing it. Dream of many dreamers. Dreaming of many dreamers. Dreaming of many dreamers. Dreaming of many dreamers. Practice full stop in the now of this wow. Full stop in the now of this wow. Stay meek, humble, unassuming. Don't run off and write a dissertation on this. Dream, I said, hey, I wonder if being on this precipice is something that I'm just dreaming. The one on the road is just dreaming that. But who is that one on the road? Maybe that one on the road is being dreamed also. And who is that also, the one who's dreaming the dreamer on the road, who's dreaming the dreamer, the one on the precipice? Who is that? Maybe there, that's being dreamed too. And so Ramana Maharshi was saying, just follow back this dreamer, follow it all the way back to its source. And then we will see the original source is a dream of dreamers. And somehow this resolves somehow. But don't try to force that. Just have faith that it will come. You see, when you look at this, then you ask, well, who am I then? I mean, I must just also be being dreamed and dreaming of dreams, dreamers. I think, who's this person? Who's this person moving around in the world? Don't worry about it. The resolution is beyond what we can probably foresee or imagine. So it's better to just stay quiet and still, calm, full stop in the now of this wow. So this is right on top of the wow of where I am, there is no down, which was just incredibly significant. There is no precipice. There's no precipice at all. All these dreams I'm having of being on this precipice that I'm starting to, if I make the slightest move, I'm going to slide off the precipice without being able to stop. You know, so many like this, dreams like this. There is no precipice. There is no down. Where I am, there is no down whatsoever. So I caught it. I said, this has to be a dream. And I started tracing it back. Well, where was I before I was on this precipice? Oh, I was on this road. Maybe it's the one on the road who's dreaming. But again, before I was on the road, where was I? Well, maybe I was back in the city or something. Okay, before I was in the city, where was I? Right? So this is sort of what Ramana says is track the origin of the I down. You see? It's a pretty amazing undertaking, but it's not impossible. I haven't tried it yet. I just made one little step there, and now I'm sort of making a second. Like, where did the one on the road? You know, maybe someone is dreaming that too. Maybe that's a dream also. I say, whoa, where does it stop? You could say this about everything. It's all a dream like this. Strong smell. I don't know what that is, wood smoke or something. I don't know. I'm supposed to get a storm coming. It's very calm now. Very calm. But tomorrow is supposed to be a very blustery, heavy rain. Supposed to get rain the next 4 days. Maybe showers for 2 of the days, but a lot of precipitation. Well, that's great. But what's that smell? Sort of familiar smell, I'm not sure what it is. Anyway, it won't do anything to the drought, really. Not that the water just disappears, but it's a start. It's a start. Just like this recognition is a start. So instead of worrying about the one on the precipice, let's just say, no, that's a dream. And who's dreaming the dream? Oh, the one on the road before they got left their car and took a walk. Well, wait a minute. Maybe that's a dream too. Well, where's the one that is dreaming about this road trip like this? Up in the mountains. And start tracing it back like that. Now, Ramana would call this true meditation, true inquiry. This is the inquiry he suggests. Trace the back, the origin of the I, the dreamer. And it started by my realizing where I am. There is no down. And then having this dream of a precipice. And then finally catching it right away and say, hey, wait a minute. If where I am, there is no down, then this is a dream I'm having, actually. There is no precipice. It started the inquiry. So Ramana says this is the fast way of today's age. Trace the eye back, but it's extraordinarily difficult to get started on this. He, no doubt, is talking to an audience, a very sophisticated meditative audience, by and large, of a culture of maybe thousands of years of meditation, contemplation. So they tacitly get it to some extent. So to trace it back, wherever there is any sense of depth or downness, that you can go down in any way, that's a dream. Take it that's a dream. So the one in the car up in the mountains, that supposedly went up onto this up in this precipice area, that one is being dreamed. Must be being dreamed also. And if you realize there's only one dreamer dreaming and one dream, a dream of dreamers, then it makes it easier to trace this back. So there must be a dreamer dreaming of the one with the car in the mountains. Where is that dreamer? Is that the original dreamer? Where is that dreamer located? So the thing to do is just say, okay, I've come across what you might say is the method of Ramana Maharshi, the meditation. Just say, okay, don't make anything of it. Who am I? Who am I? Who is the one? Who is this I? Is this real or is it a dream? Oh, that's a dream. Well, who's dreaming the dream? Well, who is that I? You know, and you trick Jason. But that's just book teaching. It's quite different. You cannot really relate it too well to a book. So Ramana was able to trace it all the way back, and then experienced the stillness, the great stillness, where there's no down. How can everywhere go down anywhere? Right? How can anywhere, everywhere go down? Any downness to everywhere? How can there be any downness to everywhereness? Now, we're not trying to study this, looking into books. Okay, what's Ramana say? Now, this is phase four. We just stay in the full stop in the now of this wow, because it's shaking us up tremendously. That's where our attention needs to be. That's why we keep finding ourselves reborn. We think we have, after the body passes away, we think we're in a higher realm and this is it. But maybe that's also just a dream. And maybe the higher realm than that is also just a dream. Where's the original dreamer, the one who dreamed a dream of dreamers? That's our identity. And you see how tricky it is. If our identity is one who's dreamed a dream of dreamers, who are also dreaming a dream of dreamers, who are also dreaming a dream of dreamers, any one of those steps it might look and say, oh, there's the dreamer who's dreaming a dream of dreamers. See that? And not gone back all the way to the original, the one and only dreamer, actually. Very clever. So the spirit is dreaming a dream of dreamers who are dreaming a dream of dreamers who are dreaming a dream of dreamers. So anywhere along there, you can say, oh, I'm aware of a dreamer who's dreaming a dream of dreamers. See? We think that's it. That must be it. But that could be anywhere along this dream of endless. Now, it seems like this would create layers and levels, right? But it doesn't at all, right? Because it's all one dream by one dreamer. How can there be layers and levels, actually? How can a dream of dreamers who are dreaming of dreamers of dreaming who are dreaming of dreamers, how can it be have actual levels to it at all? But you see, you can easily interpret that way, which is delusion. So then you think you're in a pit, having to climb out of a pit, where as a matter of fact is, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down at all. There's no pit. So once you get an insight like this, you don't have to sweat it as far as like, wow, I need to make progress or something. No, it's... This is massive progress. So we can afford here just to be quiet and patient. We're not desperate for progress. We've got all the progress we can possibly handle right here. As I've always said, the spiritual path is all about managing your success. you get all the success. How capable you are of managing your success. So this insight arose today. It means I've gone a long ways in capability of managing success on the path. If I'm able to manage this one, this is it's like a whale, you know, it's really a big one. Mood of repentance, be repentant, be humble, meek, unassuming. So, during the day, all sorts of thoughts have come up, all sorts of distractions, and I just keep saying, drop it. As soon as I can, I recognize and say, I don't need to see how this fantasy imagining turns out. Just drop it. I was watching a video of Paul McCartney, George Harrison, and Ringo Starr in I guess one of their houses, maybe George's house, real simple house. And I think this is the last time that they played together. They're just jamming acoustic guitars on a drum set. So I was watching that and I was thinking about, yeah, the Beatles. And I started thinking, and I just said, drop it. Just dropped it. So I just dropped it. So all these trains of thought during the day, I've just dropped them. Whatever it is. Even thoughts of success, just drop it. Just be empty-minded as far as concepts and thoughts, stories go. Just drop it. Don't speculate. Don't reminisce, don't speculate. So again, the capacity to just drop your train of thought, mid-sentence, mid-thought, mid-scenario. A song is playing. Oh, what a great song. Oh, I need to focus on truth. Okay, just stop. Drop the thought. Drop the song altogether. Don't even think about how it continues on, how it goes. It's like all these scripts, like for a movie, are playing in our heads. And as quick as possible, just recognize, that's not it. Drop it. And you don't never know how the script is going to play out and end up at all, right? Oh, well, another movie lost to posterity. Just drop it. The news, yeah, blah, 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 blah. Just drop all interest in it. Just drop it right now. No interest in how it may or may not turn out. Even dropping it. So at some point, we're no longer caught up in the activity of dropping it. We drop dropping it too. We drop everything, including dropping it. But that is a dropping. You see, it just doesn't let the scenario of dropping it build up in the mind. So just drop the dropping it scenario. Just stay with the full stop and the now, the wow. Don't let anything lead you away from that. How clever the mind is. How clever. Wow. So this causes a major strain, major tiring, like the after effects of shock. You feel a little bit listless, tired. This is absolutely shocking. This insight, tremendously shocking. I said, well, who am I then? I mean. Where does the dream start? Maybe I'm just a dream. What do we do about it? What's our true life like? All of this on and on and on is very disturbing in some ways. I'm getting hammered with fatigue, like it's just incredibly severe. I can barely stay awake. Wow. So there are times when it's probably best not to operate heavy machinery. Depth of this wow is so intense, so it could certainly lead to feeling a little bit of listless shock, and that sort of not quite as on top of your reactions. You know, reactions are a little it's like you're tired. When you're tired, your reactions aren't as good. I can drive, I'm aware I'm not driving as good as I normally do. So it's not like a drunkenness or anything like that. I'm aware and saying, "Huh, this is. I feel tired. I'm just drifting a little bit. I'm aware it's because of fatigue. Okay, then correct this a little bit. And say, okay, but wow, just a little." A little bit off. Old people are a little bit off, but oftentimes they don't realize it. Difference here is I'm aware of it. It's possible if you have a really super intense retreat and you're open for it, that you spend like a week or so and you're not driving, and then you get a day or something to really recover, so to speak, because it can feel shocking, yeah. dream of dreamers dreaming dreamers who are dreaming dreamers who are dreaming dreamers. And intuitively we say, wow, this really hits home. This overwhelms cognition, doesn't it? This is greater than some other idea that we've had. This is really astonishingly great idea. That's why we're all one really. There's no, that we're all being dreamed. We're all this dream of dreamers, dream of dreamers, dream of dreamers, dream of dreamers. All just one dreamer of the entire thing. So there's just one dreamer dreaming all of this. So we're all dream figures of that one dreamer. Ultimately, what we are is the dreamer. We are. Everyone is the dreamer. These dream figures are not what we are at all. We're not the body at all. This is just a dream of dreamers, dreaming dreamers. It has nothing to do with what we are. I can say I'm having more trouble now than I'm used to, or maybe ever. Feel a little bit out of it. And I can say that I've had so many dreams of being on precipices, and I feel my whole life has been on a precipice. This is how I feel. I realize it, that somehow I've lived on the edge of a precipice my entire life. It's very astonishing that my dad was a daredevil and loved to go to precipices and do handstands on the edge of precipices and challenge himself on the edge of precipices in all sorts of ways. And it always scared the dickens out of me. I hated it, couldn't stand it. I'd stay way back from the precipice, so I'm not getting close, no way. He'd be up there on the railing overlooking a complete vast precipice. You know, doing a one-armed handstand or something, you know, just completely insane. I don't like anything that has to do with precipice. No way. I feel somehow I may go over the edge, you know. It's quite something. This reminds me of something. A very amazing event took place today. I was just working out front a little bit, and I was cleaning up and walking towards the back, and I saw something sitting on the driveway, and it was a jewel, an earring. I said, huh? It's just sitting there plain as day. I just picked it up, and I've asked people, is this your earring? Is this your earring? Finally found the owner of the earring. And they say it's been months and months it's been lost, but it's sitting in the middle of the driveway, and I've walked past there, everyone, hundreds and hundreds of times. Plus I've used a leaf blower to blow off the driveway many times in those months. There's been, you know, the leaf blower would have blown it off into the side gully there, whatever, lost, gone for sure. How could it's light is very light, the leaf, and yet here it is sitting in plain sight on the driveway where I wasn't looking for it at all, but it's just obvious. Oh, the sparkling gold and this crystal sparkling. I said, oh, how could anyone not see that? And people are saying, how could you find it? It's incredible. It's a miracle. It's been missing for so long, and we've been looking for it, and it's absolutely in plain sight, right where we walk constantly. How in the world did that happen? This is a mystery. And it wasn't in some cranny or crevice wedged in there so the leaf blower, it was sitting on top of it easy. The leaf blower would have blown it away many times over. Astonishing, astonishing, astonishing. Unanswerable. Again, something that noticeable. We all are, you know, walking and scanning. It couldn't have possibly been overlooked like that. So how was it put there? You know, how did this happen? I don't have an answer for this. Now, most people are just laughing it off, and so, but I'm saying, wait a minute. Did I find the jewel, or did the jewel find me, is the question here, right? Flip the script, as I often say. Flip the script. Do you find the guru, or does the guru find you? Do you find the truth, or the truth find you? Do you find God, or does God find you? So maybe the jewel decided to find me. I can't explain it otherwise. Explain it. That one way to explain it would be, it was in a car, and somehow fell off in the car, and then somehow, in opening the door of the car, somehow it got pushed out onto the driveway. That would make sense. So it never was on the driveway in the first place. See, somehow it just had fallen out of the car just now. So that flips the script again, doesn't it? Entirely. Where we find something may not be where it's been. We assume that it's been there all the time. It may not have been there all the time. In fact, it couldn't have been there all the time. That's why I'm saying, how could we have missed it? We couldn't. So it must have fallen out of the car. But no one's really been in that passenger seat of the car. Very interesting. That's okay. But somehow, it was ready to be found, I guess, you know? So that, like in that dream on the precipice, I'm assuming I'm in this terrible situation. But again, what if I'm not in that situation? What if this is just a dream? Where does the fear go then? If you realize, oh wait a minute, I'm only dreaming. I'm on this precipice. Poof, the fear is gone. I remember reading yesterday in Journey Beyond Words, Jesus saying that if you just follow his advice in a simple manner, all your problems will be solved. All your problems will vanish for you. Guaranteed. Just give up your valuing. All your problems will vanish. Guaranteed, he says. Well, if you're having a dream of being on this precipice and you feel you're about ready to slip, And you suddenly realize, hey, wait a minute, I'm just dreaming this. You know, what happens to all the fear and the struggle, and the you know, terror, you know, I'm about ready to fall off the precipice. Oh, it's just a dream. Oh, I'm not even there at all. Poof, gone, right? Gone. To the one then who says, wow, that's kind of scary that I was dreaming a dream of being on a precipice, but what if that one too is a dreamer? Where does that concern go? Poof, gone. Then you might think, well, it's kind of scary being a dreamer who dreams of a dreamer who dreams of being on a precipice. You realize that one's a dreamer too. That one's just a being dreamed too. Poof, gone. And so if you go back enough, the distancing, precipice like that, and then you realize that the original dreamer, the one dreamer, is where that dreamer is. There is no down at all. There cannot be any precipice. So the trouble of dreaming of dreamers who are dreaming of dreamers or dreaming of dreamers, dreaming on and on and on, dreaming of a precipice, is no consequence whatsoever. And all affect from that concatenation of dreaming, that big chain of dreaming, is all gone. All the affect, the reactions, all of that. Emotions, the struggles, the fears, it's all gone. Like it never was. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. So I thought I'd have some great enlightened dreams. Instead, I had this dream of this precipice and then looking out over this world, the surface of this world, with all this huge, frantic building going on. There's some mega buildings taking place. Like the complex in Mecca near the pilgrimage site is just astonishing, truly astonishing. The height of that clock tower building and all the hotels surrounding it is just like this colossal buildings. The World Trade Center. Was it World Trade Center 1? That's quite a skyscraper too, isn't it? It's quite a building. And, you know, there's a lot of these mega buildings that have been put up recently, and probably there's some underway some places in the world too. Was that one in Dubai or something? That Burj Dubai or something? That just incredibly high building. That's way higher than the second highest building. Just this astonishing tower into the sky. Astonishing. See, so I was seeing all these of these skyscrapers, legitimate, the ones in the world, not just fake ones. I mean, I actually could recognize what they were, some of them. The towers in Kuala Lumpur, you know, the Shanghai, was the Bank Tower or something like that, and just various of the massive skyscrapers. Then I saw cranes building new ones, like the Towers of Babylon or something, trying to get up incredibly high in the sky. But where I am, there is no down. There is no down at all. There's no way to be down. There's no way to go down. So there can't be any precipice. Therefore, there can't be any fear relating to any precipice. where I am, there is no town. I'm dreaming a dream of dreamers, 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 dreaming a dream of dreamers. Fatigue has lifted a little bit. The stupor, I was really almost in a state of stupor that I was hitting so hard, seems to have lifted a little bit. So each step removed, as you go back towards the original dreamer, it seems like the affect would get less and less and less and less and less. And then where the original dreamer realizes, oh, I was only dreaming a dream of dreamers, dreaming a dream of dreamers, etc. Wait, drop that, then there's no affect at all of fear, just bliss. There is no down where I am. Where I am is. There is no down. Where everywhere is, there is no down, is there? There's no up, there's no down, there's no sideways, there isn't any of that. Few dreams are scarier than being on the edge of some vast precipice and feeling like somehow you're sort of sliding towards it inexorably, sort of you can't resist. You're getting closer and closer, and you look at your feet, and it's like just the precipice is like a foot away from your feet, just a foot away. And you feel the weight of your body is sort of, you know, any misstep or mismovement, any awkwardness, anything, you could slide off like that. And so you're just like petrified. Truly terrible feeling. And this is the result of believing that there is a down. Where I am, there is no down. So maybe we could trace it back. Wherever you find yourself, is there any way you could be down, go down? Well, then that's a dream. And keep tracing it back and ask yourself, wherever you are, is there any way I can go down? And what do you think, take yourself to be, where you are? You in some flat, you know, flat place. Well, is there any depression in any of that flat place? Well, that if there is a gully anywhere, that's a dream. So it has to be immaculately smooth, flat and smooth, immaculately so, to not be a dream. So just work on that. And could you fall what you are? Could you fall? That must be a dream then. Even if you're like you're walking on this perfectly flat smoothness, seamless smoothness. The very fact that you're walking, you could fall. So maybe you get to the point where you realize you are the flat smoothness where there is no down at all. You are that. I am that. Seamless, smoothless, flatness, no downness. I am that. accepting Vision. Difficulty of this is so difficult. I can see how people would go to sleep, or they just lose interest. They feel the consciousness seemed to have just been like going into a stupor. It was very difficult to get through that. I'm feeling better now, more normal. But wow, it was incredible. I could barely keep my eyes open. Maybe you could tell. You know, I'm just almost just feeling like I'm just going to collapse. So this is like spiritual athleticism, where you have to have the confidence and the poise to get through it. I can feel it's still lingering there. Like if we've been in a dream, the effects of that dream, trying to wake up from it, it tends to pull us back into it. Like, oh, I'm so tired, I'm so sleepy. So waking up from the dream to this mega dream, actually, is what we're looking at here. See, this isn't just waking up in the morning from a dream. This is the mega dream. This is the dream of dreamers dreaming of other dreamers who are dreaming of other dreamers. A dream of dreamers, dreaming of other dreamers, dreaming on and on and on and on and on and on. This is the universal dream. This is the mega dream. So waking up from this mega dream is a lot more difficult than waking up in the morning from your fitful slumbers. Requires a lot of discipline to try to pull out of this dream, get it, wake up from this dream. The mega dream, the one dreamer, the one dream, but it's a mega dream. A mega dream, dreaming of many dreamers who are dreaming of many dreamers, who are dreaming of many dreamers, who are dreaming of many dreamers, on and 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 on. And still more and more and more and more and more and more and more. A mega dream. But any amount of awakening you can get from this, any amount of consciousness waking up to this self-awareness, is dispelling the cobwebs, is waking up. So any amount of work you're doing on this, it is bringing you closer to finally waking up from this mega dream. And of course, you wake up, quote unquote, all at once by realizing it's all just one dream. You can't wake up from a piecemeal, really, because there's only one dreamer. It's not like, oh, okay, I located one of the dreamers and I'm waking up from that dream, so I partially am awake from that dream as dreamer. No, because that dreamer is also being dreamed. So you're not really awake at all. So of course it has to be all at once. But at the same time, you can be tracing it back and realizing, oh, this too is a dreamer. This too is a dreamer, as Ramana says. Trace back the origin of the I thought, the first thought, which is I, first thought. Which is I am dreaming. A dream of dreamers. So you think that you're the dreamer. You see, the first thought, I thought, is the thought that I am the dreamer. But this is a dream. You see, the I am the dreamer is the dream. the real dream, the actual dream, is a dream of dreamers. So when you take yourself to be a dreamer, you're still not woken up to the fact that the dream is a dream of dreamers. So that's the I thought there. And it's, oh, I am dreaming. But then, I am dreaming of what? Of dreamers. And then that seems to be another I, another level of I. And the I there says, oh, I am the dreamer. Of what? Well, I am a dreamer of dreamers. And there's another I thought, see? It goes on and on and on. The original dreamer doesn't have that. It being real has the quality of reality about it, which is bliss, freedom, peace, stillness, whereas the other dreamers don't have that. The dreaming of dreamers who are dreaming of dreamers, etc., etc., they don't have that feeling. It may seem to be very creative and innovative and all of that, but it's not the same. That's why in some teachers they say, you have realization. They say, yeah, but there's even a further realization beyond that. Well, there may be many, and those are not real realizations, actually. The real realization is the recognition that there's only one dreamer of the entire dream. The entire dream is all being dreamed by just the one dreamer, which is spirit. And there are no layers or levels whatsoever. None. There haven't been any secondary dreamers whatsoever. Not any. The entire thing just flattens out. And that's where we can say, where I am, there is no down whatsoever. The entire thing flattens out. It all flattens out. If the storm will get here. There's no sign of it yet. So what kind of dream am I going to have tonight, is the question. Right? What do we dream of when we see this? I don't know. I really don't know at all. Last night it was the precipice, but what could it be tonight? Maybe there's some like awareness creeping in to catch the dream, say, wait a minute, this is a dream. Maybe awareness will somehow creep in. I don't know what's going to happen. But have some, at least feel enough positivity that I'm staying disciplined in this. You know, I feel like there's some payoff coming. So I stayed disciplined today. A lot of bad habits tried to creep in, but I said, no. Let's stay disciplined on this one. It's too important. It's like seeing a plant with all these, the flower plant with all these buds on it, really big buds, and it looks like they're ready to open up, and you say, you know what, I think I'm just going to hang in here a little longer, and just because I believe that they're going to open up, so maybe they will, maybe they won't, but it looks like they will. Part of the discipline and the maturity on the path, of course, is just getting to this point. You don't know what is next. There has to be some sort of basic faith and confidence that you'll be able to handle whatever is next, that somehow the Holy Spirit will see you through, no matter what. You just have to maintain your discipline, and for sure you'll be okay. So this is the feeling that I have. Otherwise, I'd be kind of concerned about what's going to happen next. But I try not to think about it at all, really. Because I say, well, whatever it is, I'll be able to do it pretty well. It's like if you're a really good piano player and someone just keeps putting new sheet music on your piano. And you don't know what they're going to put there next. You play one song and say, okay, finally got that one. It's a very difficult song. And you don't know what they're going to put there next at all. You say, wow. I wonder if it'll be too difficult. I mean, but I say, like, you know, no, if you're a really good piano player, you'll say, I'll be able to do the song justice to some extent, whatever it is. I mean, how bad can I play? I know I'm going to be able to play something good. You know, I may not be able to play it perfectly or expertly if it's just too, you know, incredibly complex and difficult, but I'm sure whatever I play, I'll find a way to make it sound really good. So it's that kind of confidence. And when things get too tough, I go back to the only problem that I have is the continuity problem. I don't have a whatever problem. I don't have a figuring out a dream problem. I don't have a future problem. I don't have a what is the future going to be like problem at all. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The what is the future going to be problem doesn't exist. Therefore, has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Because only the vision of oneness resolves my one and only problem, which is the continuity problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. No one has any other problem. The only problem there is the continuity problem, actually. Everyone has exactly the same problem, which is a continuity problem, and there isn't any other problem. And you go to work on it like this, and this definitely will calm you down and center you if you feel like that you're concerned about maybe the music will get too tough to play, you know? I just have a simple problem. It's very severe, but it's a simple problem. So. You know, however difficult the score is, the notes are still on all the notes are still on the piano. It's the same notes, same piano, same place, same bench, same sitting. All the keys are still on the piano, same keys, you know. It's not like they're going to say, well, play some notes that are not on the piano, you know. So you say, well, why should I worry too much? I know where the notes are. Sit here quietly, full stop in the now with this wow. I do not have a dreaming problem. I have a continuity problem. The dreaming problem doesn't really exist. Therefore, it doesn't have any value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the continuity problem exists. And even that is only temporary, but only the continuity problem exists. If it weren't for the continuity problem, the dream, we'd wait, stop dreaming immediately. So this other stuff doesn't really exist. It only exists contingent upon the continuity problem. So it's the continuity problem that really exists, not the other. The other's just an effect of the continuity problem. So it has no meaning for me. Only the vision of oneness has meaning. It has no value. It has absolutely no value for me whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value. So you need these techniques in phase four to get through the tough spots, because certainly it's very challenging situation. But it's fun. I mean, this is a career. I mean, this is a vocation, a career, a hobby, a pastime. What is so interesting? You know, this is what you do. This is the passion in life. This is your life. This is what is interesting. This is what is compelling. This is what makes life interesting, right? The situation here interesting is the spiritual path. There's nothing even close to it in terms of being compelling. Nothing even close. You see, and again, I always say the drug path is not it at all. Because here, you know, it's not the result of drugs. You know you're getting it straight, clear, and you have access to this all the time. And you're with it, actually. It's real. Yeah, I mean, this is happening. It's not just some fantasy, drug-induced fantasy or anything like that. That's going to fade away. So that means it's just exponentially, incomprehensibly more intense. Because you say that this is really happening. I'm really succeeding. This is really taking place. This is not some drug trip. This is actually taking place. Inherently, based on my actual progress, you see. Not because I took a whole bunch of drugs, but because actually I've made all this progress. So that just life causes the whole thing to just be like just a tremendous spiritual trip here. Can't even compare. But it's dissimilar to drug trips. So it's not like just some super drug trip. No, not at all. It's different. It's very different. It's grounded in success, grounded in actual momentum, success, clarity, knowing that you can continue on, knowing that you can maintain your poise, knowing that tomorrow you're going to be further along. See, knowing all of this, it's a trip. It's a spiritual trip. It's the one trip. It's the biggest trip there is. But you got to go on this trip sober. Have to go on this trip sober. And a lot of people realize that eventually, right? They realize, wow, I'm missing out. You know, all the party people, they're missing out big time. And they, of course, they pretend they're not. They're very good at pretending they're not. They put on airs, you know, they're pretending. But deep down, they know they're missing out on something really big, and it bothers them. It gnaws on them, you know, really eats them up. So they keep trying to put on greater airs. No, we're really having some great trip here, you know. No, they're missing out on this, on the one big, true, great trip there is. This path, spiritual pilgrimage. That is the big trip. That is the big trip. So you might say, I'm really tripping. Really, really, really tripping, naturally. Going through that fatigue, going through this, you know, it's happening, you know. You realize these are reactions to moving the comfort zone closer to awakening, to realization. How intense is that? How intense is closing in on realization? Actually closing in on it is a, not just having some fantasy, drug fantasy, that you know will fade away into a memory or something. Now actually opening your eyes to it with a full consciousness and clarity and sobriety and focus and attention behind it. employees, you see. How intense is that? How cool is that? That is really a trip. So we're really tripping here, actually. And it's poetic justice, being a child of the 60s, that I'm actually really tripping, you see. Really tripping. I wasn't really into tripping in the 60s and the 70s, no, not really, no. Because I said, hey, this isn't really tripping. This isn't where it's at. Like, I know something's better. So I felt there was something way better. I was reading all these spiritual books, and I said, you know, this stuff is pointing to something. I feel it's way superior to all this tripping that's going on. They thought they were smarter and better, because they said, well, we can trip when we want to and not trip. You see, we can get off the trip at any time we want and go back to it. Whereas you know, you're always working at this. And yeah. So they thought they were outsmarting, they're being smarter. But by doing that, they missed the real trip, the one big trip, which requires momentum, which requires stick-to-itiveness, which requires spiritual discernment, which requires everydayness, moving the trip further and further and further and further. This is the real further. This is the real further. This is not the merry pranksters on some psychedelic bus blitzing through the country, stoned out of their minds. This is the real further. This has real consequence. You don't just drop out of this. You don't just set this aside. So again, this is what makes life bearable, I guess, and the existence, a bearable existence. So I feel like I've come out of that knockout phase there, where I could hardly keep my consciousness awake there. Okay, very great. Super intense. Phase 4. There's nothing cooler than phase 4. That is for sure. All the phases are very cool. For instance, I go to church as phase 1 and join the phase 1ers there, and that's very cool for them. I mean, it is. it's very cool. Phase 2, you know, the recluse hermit studying, clearer explanations of what it's really about. Well, that's like super cool. Oh, wow, that was so intense. Phase 3, examining the value of the world. That was just off the charts intense. It was so intense, I can't even describe it. I can hardly believe it. But the phase 4 now, phase 4 is there's more maturity, but it's needed, because the intensity here is just the generalization, the ramification, you know, realizing, hey, I'm succeeding, this is going to happen. There's no greater intensity than that. That is for sure. So, all 4 phases have their own intensity, and they're all very intense. But living a life of intensity like this is certainly the way to go. Certainly the way to go. Don't shortchange yourself. Don't shortchange yourself. Keep on building that momentum. Keep on with your intensity. Because you'll get the self-respect, like, hey, I'm using my time in the right way here. Using my time in the right way. That'll attract teachers. It'll attract help. It'll attract top-tier teachers. They know who's like Santa Claus. They know who's been naughty and who's been nice. They know who's building the momentum. They know, and who's not. Who's just copping out with drugs. Popping out in some way, thinking, "Oh yeah, this is a trip." No, it's the everyday working at it, slaving away at it. That's the real trip. Okay, very great. Just keep on keeping on, and we will offer help here. The tools that are necessary, the tools that really help. Keep you centered. Don't make anything of it. Don't make anything of it. Just stay centered, full stop, in the now of this wow, as we continue to trigger deeper and deeper wows for space. That's it.